Hello, everyone. Thank you. On behalf of Consumer Energy Alliance, Colorado Mesa University Unconventional Energy Center, West Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association, and Chevron, I would like to welcome you to the third of our Student Energy Series at CMU. We're going to have a panel discussion focused on the importance of responsible energy development in the context of jobs, the economy, and revitalization of the domestic manufacturing sector. This is a unique event for you all in the Piceance Basin. Key players in the manufacturing sector are revolutionizing how end users manage factory input and raw material costs by direct energy investments. Nucor Corporation, North America's largest steel manufacturer, G2X Energy, and future overseas customers of LNG export terminals like Jordan Cove LNG are leading the way in investing and providing markets for natural gas production in Western Colorado. These investments by manufacturers signify a new era of long-term partnerships between the natural gas industry and industrial consumers that provide large manufacturers with economic and environmental incentives to expand operations in the United States to take advantage of our abundant and secure natural gas resources. Our panelist members are Joe Stratman, Executive Vice President with Nucor Corporation, Danny Wilson, Executive Vice President, Upstream G2X Energy, Bob Braddock, Senior Project Advisor for Jordan Cove LNG, and will be moderated by John Harbaugh, Founder and President of Mercator Energy. So we'll begin by a 10-minute project overview from each of the panelists. And just to provide context for the moderated discussion, which will follow, and that will last 1 hour. And then we'll have time for about 20-plus minutes of Q&A from the audience. During the moderated discussion, if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll give you an index card and a pencil to write it out and hand it to John, our moderator, who will choose the question he thinks are most relative to the conversation that's ongoing. So this is an open forum, freedom of thought. We're in an academic setting, but we just ask that everyone be respectful. And these gentlemen are not afraid of hard questions, but please be courteous and thoughtful in your questions and remarks. With that, please give a round of applause for our panelists and moderator. Thank you. Joe, I believe you're up first.
Okay. Not in these, or?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
How is everybody today? You have to be good on a day like today. It's gorgeous outside. First of all, I want to thank everyone for having us here today. This is really an exciting opportunity for Nucor to be on this panel and to be a part of the Western Slopes Colorado Oil and Gas Association. Our venture into the natural gas world, the oil and gas world, started probably about 2008, 2009. When we were up against some strategic hurdles in what we'll call our raw materials supply chain. And that led us down a path of education, which I've got to be honest with you, I'm not even sure I knew how to spell natural gas back in 2008, but now my team and I know a lot more about it, and we're very honored to be a part of this industry in a really small way that we are. So what I wanted to start today with is just give you some sense of who Nucor is, the breadth of our company, what we do, and hopefully tie in a little bit of why energy in general, natural gas specifically, is so important to our company. So our company is primarily, you'll know us as a steel making company, but we are a lot more than just a steel making company. We really have four strategic business focuses. We start with actually the raw material portion of our business. We own and operate recycling yards all across the country. In fact, we have one right here in Grand Junction called Western Metals Recycling. I believe it's over on 4th Street, 4th Avenue. I'm not sure if I got Street and Avenue right, but it's over on 4th. That is actually a Nucor company, Western Metals Recycling. We have approximately 65 or 75 similar locations all over the country, and we actually collect and recycle scrap metals, ferrous metals, steel, non-ferrous metals like copper and aluminum. We recycle these, so we take your old dishwashers, we take your old cars, we take your old washing machines. We break them down into the various usable components, and then we recycle them. We'll either use them ourselves internally, most of it. In some cases, we sell it to other industries that consume the copper and the aluminum. So we start with recycling. And our core raw material into our steelmaking process. But also as part of our raw materials strategy, scrap metal is actually a very, very precious commodity. There is not enough necessarily in the United States to supply all the needs. And indeed, it is a global commodity. So at different times in the economic cycle, you could have as much as 20-25% of all the scrap metal recycled in the United States sold offshore. So in 2008, we started noticing this trend and this change. We said we need to get a different element, another leg on the stool of our raw material strategy. And that leg took the form of a manufacturing plant in Louisiana, which uses a technology called DRI, directly reduced iron. This technology basically takes iron ore, processed iron ore from the ground, and heats it up and reduces it, almost melts it, but not quite liquid, but puts it into a very pure iron form. And guess what the energy source for a DRI plant is? Anybody? Natural gas. Now this DRI technology is not new technology. We did not create, a new thing. It's been around for decades. And in fact, there was a DRI plant owned by another company in the state of Louisiana in the middle part of the 1990s. But guess what happened with natural gas prices back in the 90s, in the early part of the decade? They went from $2, $3, $4 all the way up into the $8, $9, $10. I think it even peaked up in the $12, $15 range. Somebody in here will know that better than me. And because the cost and the amount of natural gas used in that process is so influential, it actually put that company out of business. So guess what? We bought the assets of that company. We relocated those assets for our first plant on the island of Trinidad, just off the coast of Venezuela, because they had a long-term contract for natural gas at $2 a unit. We couldn't afford it in the United States at that time. But with the evolution of the shale gas revolution and the energy revolution that's going on in the United States, we've been able to get natural gas at competitive prices. So we built a second plant in Louisiana, literally about a mile away from where that first plant that I talked about that had gone bankrupt and we bought it. We located a brand new plant about a mile away from that. So that's just an indication of how integrated and how important natural gas and the whole energy revolution that's going on in the United States, how important it is to manufacturers. So that's kind of our raw material strategy. Our raw materials then feeds a steel mill group. We have 28 steel mills spread around the country. We make about 20 million tons of steel. 85% of our raw material comes from recycled scrap metal. We are the nation's largest recycler. We're the nation's largest recycling company. Our steel goes into lots of different products. You'll see a collage of pictures here in a moment of the different things our steel products go into. Our steel goes into different products, heavily dominated by construction, but automotive, energy. We sell about 1 million tons of steel to producers of OCTG pipe for the oil and gas industry. And then we also have a trading network where we trade steel around the globe. This is our footprint. So as you can see, we're a North American focused company, predominantly a US focused company, but we have facilities throughout North America, small footprint in Mexico, pretty large footprint in Canada, but we're primarily a US-based company. And if I can read this correctly, The red dots represent our steel mills. The blue dots represent our steel products, where we make various and sundry products, mostly for construction. The yellow represents our raw materials facilities, which is, again, predominantly recycling activity, metals recycling activities. And then the dark blue represents
joint ventures.
The purple color represents joint ventures. So that's our footprint. We have about 24,000 teammates across this footprint. We have a corporate culture that is focused on safety first, environmental compliance, productivity, profitability, working together. We have a very empowered, teamwork-oriented culture in our corporation. And I'll leave you and turn it over to the next speaker with, I'll tell you what our mission statement is. And if you walk up to almost any new core teammate, almost any of the 24,000 teammates around the country, in Canada and Mexico, almost every one of them can repeat for you what our mission statement is. And it goes like this: our mission is to take care of our customers. We define our customers as the people who use our products, as the teammates that we work side by side with, our shareholders, and the communities in which we live and work. We will accomplish this goal by being the safest, the highest quality, the lowest cost, most productive, and most profitable steel and steel products company in the entire world. We'll do this by being cultural and environmental stewards in the communities that we live and work, and we'll all accomplish this by working together. That is the mission statement of our company. That's what we live and breathe every day, and it's what we live and breathe across all 24,000 teammates. So with that short introduction to Nucor, I'll turn it over to Andrew.
Thank you. Danny Wilson, come up, please.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Joe, for your great talk. I want to thank the Colorado Mesa University, Chevron, and the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association for hosting this event and asking G2X to be part of the panel with such good experts from Nucor and Jordan Cove. I'm delighted to be here today to see and see all of you to learn more about the Piceance gas production and how that U.S. natural gas production is being used for LNG exports, which Bob is going to talk about, downstream petrochemical uses, which we're involved in, and the plant fuel to make products such as steel making done by Nucor, which he just talked about, some of which is made by others into oil field pipe that's used in the oil and gas industry. G2X Energy is a subsidiary of a global company, Promant Holdings AG, which is headquartered in Switzerland, but has operations in 9 other countries around the world. G2X, we develop, build, own, and operate vertically integrated petrochemical facilities in the U.S. where we can take advantage of the low-cost domestic natural gas that Joe was talking about. Right now, we operate a plant in Pampa, Texas, and in April 2016, the company announced a large acquisition where we bought 50% interest in a large facility that's going to be a methanol plant called Net Gasoline, and this facility is in Beaumont, Texas. When it's completed and on production, with first sales in September of this year, it'll be the largest methanol facility in North America. And combined, these two plants that we have will consume over 165 million cubic feet of natural gas, which is quite a large sum of natural gas. At the peak of the construction, which is occurring approximately now, the plant will have over 1,800 contractors, and on completion, we'll have more than 100 high-quality permanent jobs that'll be working at the facility. As Joe talked about, this is one of the great outcomes of the U.S. gas production revolution that has occurred over the last 5 to 10 years. This abundant supply of low-cost natural gas, such as we have here in the Piceance, will help companies provide to workers, you know, quality jobs in the U.S. Nucor's steel manufacturing plants, the Jordan Cove LNG plant that you'll hear about after me, and G2X plants are just a few examples. And we're very excited, G2X is very excited to be part of this in a major way. Excuse me. Next slide. Since G2X's main product in the U.S. will be the conversion of natural gas to methanol, I thought I'd throw up a slide that gives you some information on methanol. I know when I first came to work for G2X, I've heard of methanol, but I didn't know all of the things that methanol is used for, and we encounter those daily in our lives. It's used to make many products like paints, plastics, formaldehyde, which is used to make adhesives, some of which are used to make plywood, cabinets and countertops that are used in the housing industry, many products that are used in the automotive industry. And methanol can also be used as a clean burning fuel to generate power and as an automotive fuel additive where it's blended into gasoline and diesel. And a lot of that helps companies lower the emissions of burning these fuels. Our strategy when I came on board is take advantage of the low-cost natural gas in the U.S. So what we looked at is where can we find a nice position with a great operator to come in and buy reserves in the ground. Because our plants, we're in the gas production business for the long haul. These plants are going to last 25 to 30 years. So what we looked at doing was buy gas reserves in the ground as a hedge against long-term natural gas prices. We're currently in a joint venture with a company called Terrier Energy Partners, which a lot of you are probably familiar with. They're a great partner. They bought out WPX's interest in the area. And now are one of the major players in the Piceance Basin, and I know is very supportive in local communities here. We made this investment for several factors. The size of the resource in the Piceance Basin, the continuous land position that we have there that had been de-risked by almost 102 wells that have been drilled, a large inventory of wells that are to be drilled, will probably have the opportunity to drill over 1,000 more wells. And then excellent access to natural gas markets coming out of the Piceance. And you can see on the right just a little bit of a illustration on what the Williams Park production formation looks like. You know, we all talk about the shale gas revolution, but the production in the Piceance is really not from shale, it's from tight sands, and they're stacked multiple sand and lenses over a 2,500 to 3,000 foot interval in the Williams Fork formation. And that's the kind of production we're looking for in the Piceance, as others are. And the nice thing about the technology now, we have lower footprints in the Piceance and other places in the oil and gas industry. One of these pads can drill 25 to 30 wells off of one pad. I don't know if you can see there, but you can see the wells coming off like a spider leg, and you can tap the locations underground. But instead of having 30 pads on the surface, we'll have one pad. So it's great environmentally and softens the footprint. I put this slide in here just as an illustration of how gas flows out of the Piceance. You know, our gas flows from the wellhead to eventual cells on the right hand. The gas is gathered in the field by the gathering system of the operator. It goes through the Crawford Trail compressor station, and then it goes through what we call the parachute plant, which is a refrigeration plant. It knocks out condensate and some of the heavier natural gas liquids, such as propane and butane. Then that gas is gone. The remaining gas goes to one of three cryogenic plants where additional natural gas liquids are knocked out. Once it goes to the plants, it comes out of the tail gas of the plant as what we call residue gas. and then that gas is sold into the market. G2X markets and sells most of its own gas at the, what we call the White River Hub, and then that gas is taken to the Midwest or other places where other companies similar to us make other products. And then some of the gas is sold by our operating partner, Terra Energy, and then that gas is sold into the Colorado Interstate Market, and some of it ends up in Colorado and could end up in the Pacific Northwest and be utilized for the Jordan Cove LNG facility. So that's a short introduction of who we are. We're excited to be in the Piceance. So we love the area, love the community, and we're happy to be partners with Terra, and always happy to hear the things that the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association is doing for the industry. And we want to be good partners and good stewards of the environment, and we're just excited to be part of this area. Thank you.
Thank you all for having us here today. I'm Bob Braddock with Jordan Cove Energy, and Jordan Cove Energy is a LNG export project being developed by Veresen Corporation out of Calgary, Alberta. Go ahead. That's the typical boilerplate, roll through that. Veresen is unlike the companies that Danny and Joe talked about, is a service provider. We are an infrastructure company, primarily in natural gas. We started our company with the construction of the largest natural gas pipeline in North America, running from northeastern British Columbia all the way to the city gates of Chicago, and have expanded upon that and now own other pipelines both in Canada and the U.S. We are half owner of the Ruby Pipeline, which is a primary conduit for moving gas from the Piceance west into Northern California. The Jordan Cove project is a continuation of that, and that what it does, it builds upon the Ruby Pipeline, which takes gas from the Opal Wyoming hub, which gathers gas in the basin, brings it all the way to a market hub of Malin, Oregon, which is on the California border. And at Malin, there are pipelines that come in there from Canada and then go out of there into Northern California and into Reno, Nevada, to serve that market. We would build a pipeline, the Pacific Connector Pipeline, which would be a part of our Jordan Cove project, to move natural gas to the West Coast, 233-mile pipeline to go to Coos Bay, Oregon. Next slide. And at Coos Bay, Oregon, we will be building a facility, the Jordan Cove project, which then takes the natural gas and liquefies it. And the reason you do that is that when you liquefy natural gas, you increase the density of the gas by 600 times, making it economic to transport in bulk, very much like you would oil or gasoline. The importance of that is what that does, it creates markets that can be now served by ship. So whereas historically North American gas has been landlocked, what happens when you liquefy it, you now can load it on a ship and it can go anywhere in the world. A little over a year ago, the first LNG export facility in the US, lower 48 US, was put online on the Gulf Coast, and since that time has been shipping gas essentially all over the world. We would do the same thing with our focus being the Pacific Basin. Next slide. The facility is a fairly significant capital investment. Pipeline and the plant itself will total approximately $7 to $8 billion when we load in all interest during construction. We have the site in place, anticipate that this facility would be in service in 2024. It's a 5-year construction cycle. We are now in the final phases of a permitting cycle that seems to have gone on forever. We hope we're in the last stretch, and over the next 18 months should wrap things up and move forward. The facility has already been designed. We are in the process of selecting a contractor, which should be done next week. So we're about there. After a very rigorous engineering design process, but the facilities are pretty straightforward. It's just essentially taking gas and running it through a giant refrigerator like you have in your kitchen. It just takes it down to minus 260 degrees, at which point natural gas becomes liquid. Next. You can then load it on a vessel. This is a picture of the energy horizon. And the energy horizon is one of the largest LNG vessels that can now transit the new Panama Canal. It has a capacity of 3.9 billion cubic feet of gas. To put that into context, all the gas produced out of northwestern Colorado today, about 1.5 BCF a day, plus or minus, if I'm not out of part. So we can essentially take 2 days of all the gas produced in western Colorado and load it on that. Our facility will load one of those vessels every 3.2 days. These facilities run like clockwork as infrastructure. We do not own the gas. We do not own the LNG. We provide a service to those who own the gas and those who want to use the gas. So our customers will be either producers, other transporters of gas, or end users. Our predominant customers for our facility are essentially Japanese utilities who rely on natural gas to keep the lights on in Tokyo. Next slide. This gives you a general footprint of where LNG is being produced today, historically, and the new centers. And the new centers that are being developed are the aquamarine or greenish dots. And you can see the two in North America. We have one in the Northwest, which comprises our facility and potential facilities in British Columbia, as well as a cluster of facilities on the US Gulf Coast. These are new markets for North American natural gas. Next slide. The reason we are important, and we believe our project, which has direct access to Piceance Basin gas, is important, is that for our Japanese customers, the shipping time is 9 days to get that gas from North America to their facility. If they bring it from the Gulf Coast, it's twice that time. The importance of that, this is a continuous supply chain, just-in-time management. LNG is very expensive to store. They do not have enormous amount of LNG storage, so they have to have continuous replenishment of supply. The supply chain is important as in anything. I mean, just like Amazon tries to do everything they can to shorten that supply chain and the time, we are doing the same. The 9 days difference means that if our customers wanted to get all their gas out of the Gulf Coast versus out of Coos Bay, where we are located, they would need to have twice the number of vessels dedicated to bring that constant volume. each of these vessels is approximately $200 to $250 million investment. So forget about operating costs, forget about the time, just capital investment. It's, they're going to have twice as much in ships. To move our product, which is one BCF a day production, takes approximately 7 ships. It would take then 14 ships to do that if we were producing it and going to the same destination. Next slide. The destination. This is one of the destinations. This is a facility in Tokyo Bay owned by Tokyo Electric Power. It is their newest power plant and a storage facility. You can see the tankage there. They have 2 berths. That power plant alone, that complex of power plants, uses 0.84 BCF a day. That terminal and 3 others that are owned by TEPCO in Tokyo Bay receive 4 BCF a day. They receive a ship every 18 hours. It is a like clockwork, and therefore they are most concerned about not just price, but security of supply, reliability of delivery. They accomplish this by having diversity of supply, so they will not just rely on North America, they will go elsewhere, and historically they have not had an opportunity to rely on North America. We provide them stability, reliability, and a new source, and this is very important. So it opens up the Piceance Basin gas to a whole new market with different characteristics that have historically been supported. And that's what we do. We're a service provider linking end users, such as the folks that in Japan, with the producers here in North America. And beyond that, we'll let her go. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll begin our moderated discussion. Do you want to move the chairs in the middle, or what are you more comfortable with, John?
It might be easier for the cameraman. We can slide them over.
Okay, do that. Maybe I'll. Hello, everyone. Thank you. On behalf of Consumer Energy Alliance, Colorado Mesa University Unconventional Energy Center, West Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association, and Chevron, I would like to welcome you to the third of our student energy series at CMU. We're going to have a panel discussion focused on the importance of responsible energy development, the context of jobs, the economy, and revitalization of the domestic manufacturing sector. This is a unique event for you all in the Piceance Basin. Key players in the manufacturing sector are revolutionizing how end users manage factory input and raw material costs by direct energy investments. Nucor Corporation, North America's largest steel manufacturer, G2X Energy, and future overseas customers of LNG export terminals like Jordan Cove LNG are leading the way in investing and providing markets for natural gas production in Western Colorado. These investments by manufacturers signify a new era of long-term partnerships between the natural gas industry and industrial consumers that provide large manufacturers with economic and environmental incentives to expand operations in the United States to take advantage of our abundant and secure natural gas resources. Our panelist members are Joe Stratman, Executive Vice President with Nucor Corporation; Danny Wilson, Executive Vice President, Upstream G2X Energy; Bob Braddock, Senior Project Advisor for Jordan Cove LNG, and will be moderated by John Harbaugh, Founder and President of Mercator Energy. So we'll begin by a 10-minute project overview from each of the panelists. And just to provide context for the moderated discussion, which will follow, and that will last 1 hour. And then we'll have time for about 20-plus minutes of Q&A from the audience. During the moderated discussion, if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll give you an index card and a pencil to write it out and hand it to John, our moderator, who will choose the question he thinks are most relative to the conversation that's ongoing. So this is an open forum, freedom of thought. We're in an academic setting, but we just ask that everyone be respectful. And these gentlemen are not afraid of hard questions, but please be courteous and thoughtful in your questions and remarks. With that, please give a round of applause for our panelists and moderator. Thank you.
Joe, I'll move you up to that first.
Okay.
Not in these, or?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
How is everybody today?
Good.
You have to be good on a day like today. It's gorgeous outside. First of all, I want to thank everyone for having us here today. This is really an exciting opportunity for Nucor to be on this panel and to be a part of the Western Slopes Colorado Oil and Gas Association. Our venture into the natural gas world, the oil and gas world, started probably about 2008, 2009, when we were up against some strategic hurdles in what we'll call our raw materials supply chain. And that led us down a path of education, which I've got to be honest with you, I'm not even sure I knew how to spell natural gas back in 2008, but now my team and I know a lot more about it, and we're very honored to be a part of this industry in a really small way that we are. So what I wanted to start today with is just give you some sense of who Nucor is, the breadth of our company, what we do, and hopefully tie in a little bit of why energy in general, natural gas specifically, is so important to our company. So our company is primarily, you'll know us as a steel making company, but we are a lot more than just a steel making company. We really have four strategic business focuses. We start with actually the raw material portion of our business. We own and operate recycling yards all across the country. In fact, we have one right here in Grand Junction called Western Metals Recycling. I believe it's over on 4th Street, 4th Avenue. I'm not sure if I got Street and Avenue right, but it's over on 4th. That is actually a Nucor company, Western Metals Recycling. We have approximately 65 or 75 similar locations all over the country. And we actually collect and recycle scrap metals, ferrous metals, steel, non-ferrous metals like copper and aluminum. We recycle these. So we take your old dishwashers, we take your old cars, we take your old washing machines. We break them down into the various usable components, and then we recycle them. We'll either use them ourselves internally, most of it. In some cases, we sell it to other industries that consume the copper and the aluminum. So we start with recycling, and our core raw material into our steelmaking process. But also as part of our raw materials strategy, scrap metal is actually a very, very precious commodity. There is not enough necessarily in the United States to supply all the needs, and indeed it is a global commodity. So at different times in the economic cycle, you could have as much as 20-25% of all the scrap metal recycled in the United States sold offshore. So in 2008, we started noticing this trend and this change. We said we need to get a different element, another leg on the stool of our raw material strategy. And that leg took the form of a manufacturing plant in Louisiana, which uses a technology called DRI, directly reduced iron. This technology basically takes iron ore, processed iron ore from the ground, and heats it up and reduces it, almost melts it, but not quite liquid, but puts it into a very pure iron form. And guess what the energy source for a DRI plant is? Anybody? Natural gas. Now this DRI technology is not new technology. We did not create you know, a new thing. It's been around for decades. And in fact, there was a DRI plant owned by another company in the state of Louisiana in the middle part of the 1990s. But guess what happened with natural gas prices back in the 90s, in the early part of the decade? They went from $2, $3, $4 all the way up into the 8, 9, 10. I think it even peaked up in the 12, 15 range. Somebody in here will know that better than me. And because the cost and the amount of natural gas used in that process is so influential, it actually put that company out of business. So guess what? We bought the assets of that company. We relocated those assets for our first plant on the island of Trinidad, just off the coast of Venezuela, because they had a long-term contract for natural gas at $2 a unit. We couldn't afford it in the United States at that time. But with the evolution of the shale gas revolution and the energy revolution that's going on in the United States, we've been able to get natural gas at competitive prices. So we built a second plant in Louisiana, literally about a mile away from where that first plant that I talked about that had gone bankrupt and we bought it. We located a brand new plant about a mile away from that. So that's just an indication of how integrated and how important natural gas and the whole energy revolution that's going on in the United States, how important it is to manufacturers. So that's kind of our raw material strategy. Our raw materials then feeds a steel mill group. We have 28 steel mills spread around the country. We make about 20 million tons of steel. 85% of our raw material comes from recycled scrap metal. We are the nation's largest recycler. We're the nation's largest recycling company. Our steel goes into lots of different products. You'll see a collage of pictures here in a moment of the different things our steel products go into. Our steel goes into different products, heavily dominated by construction, but automotive, energy. We sell about 1 million tons of steel to producers of OTCG pipe for the oil and gas industry. And then we also have a trading network where we trade steel around the globe. This is our footprint. So as you can see, we're a North American focused company, predominantly a US focused company, but we have facilities throughout North America, small footprint in Mexico, pretty large footprint in Canada, but we're primarily a US based company. And if I can read this correctly, the red dots represent our steel mills. The blue dots represent our steel products, where we make various and sundry products, mostly for construction. The yellow represents our raw materials facilities, which is, again, predominantly recycling activity, metals recycling activities. And then the dark blue represents
joint ventures.
Joint ventures. The purple color represents joint ventures. So that's our footprint. We have about 24,000 teammates across this footprint. We have a corporate culture that is focused on safety first, environmental compliance, productivity, profitability, working together. We have a very empowered, teamwork-oriented culture in our corporation. And I'll leave you and turn it over to the next speaker with, I'll tell you what our mission statement is. And if you walk up to almost any new core teammate, almost any of the 24,000 teammates around the country, in Canada and Mexico, almost every one of them can repeat for you what our mission statement is. And it goes like this: our mission is to take care of our customers. We define our customers as the people who use our products, as the teammates that we work side by side with, our shareholders, and the communities in which we live and work. We will accomplish this goal by being the safest, the highest quality, the lowest cost, most productive, and most profitable steel and steel products company in the entire world. We'll do this by being cultural and environmental stewards in the communities that we live and work, and we'll all accomplish this by working together. That is the mission statement of our company. That's what we live and breathe every day, and it's what we live and breathe across all 24,000 teammates. So with that short introduction to Nucor, I'll turn it over to Andrew.
Thank you. Danny Wilson, come up, please.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Joe, for your great talk. I want to thank the Colorado Mesa University, Chevron, and the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association for hosting this event and asking G2X to be part of the panel with such good experts from Nucor and Jordan Cove. I'm delighted to be here today to see all of you to learn more about the Piceance gas production and how that U.S. natural gas production is being used for LNG exports, which Bob is going to talk about, downstream petrochemical uses, which we're involved in, and the plant fuel to make products such as steel making done by Nucor, which you just talked about, some of which is made by others into oil field pipe that's used in the oil and gas industry. G2X Energy is a subsidiary of a global company, Proman Holdings AG, which is headquartered in Switzerland, but has operations in 9 other countries around the world. G2X, we develop, build, own, and operate vertically integrated petrochemical facilities in the U.S. where we can take advantage of the low-cost domestic natural gas that Joe was talking about. Right now, we operate a plant in Pampa, Texas, and in April 2016, the company announced a large acquisition where we bought 50% interest in a large facility that's going to be a methanol plant called Net Gasoline, and this facility is in Beaumont, Texas. When it's completed and on production, with first sales in September of this year, it'll be the largest methanol facility in North America. And combined, these two plants that we have will consume over 165 million cubic feet of natural gas, which is quite a large sum of natural gas. At the peak of the construction, which is occurring approximately now, the plant will have over 1,800 contractors, and on completion, we'll have more than 100 high-quality permanent jobs that will be working at the facility. As Joe talked about, this is one of the great outcomes of the U.S. gas production revolution that has occurred over the last 5 to 10 years. This abundant supply of low-cost natural gas, such as we have here in the Piceance, will help companies provide to workers quality jobs in the U.S. Nucor's steel manufacturing plants, the Jordan Cove LNG plant that you'll hear about after me, and G2X plants are just a few examples. And we're very excited, G2X is very excited to be part of this in a major way. Excuse me. Next slide. Since G2X's main product in the U.S. will be the conversion of natural gas to methanol, I thought I'd throw up a slide that gives you some information on methanol. I know when I first came to work for G2X, I've heard of methanol, but I didn't know all of the things that methanol is used for, and we encounter those daily in our lives. It's used to make many products like paints, plastics, formaldehyde, which is used to make adhesives, some of which are used to make plywood, cabinets and countertops that are used in the housing industry, many products that are used in the automotive industry. And methanol can also be used as a clean burning fuel to generate power and as an automotive fuel additive where it's blended into gasoline and diesel. And a lot of that helps companies lower the emissions of burning these fuels. Our strategy when I came on board is take advantage of the low-cost natural gas in the U.S. So what we looked at is where can we find a nice position with a great operator to come in and buy reserves in the ground. Because our plants, we're in the gas production business for the long haul. These plants are going to last 25 to 30 years. So what we looked at doing was buy gas reserves in the ground as a hedge against long-term natural gas prices. We're currently in a joint venture with a company called Terrier Energy Partners, which a lot of you are probably familiar with. They're a great partner. They bought out WPX's interest in the area, and now are one of the major players in the Piceance Basin, and I know is very supportive in the local communities here. We made this investment for several factors. The size of the resource in the Piceance Basin, the continuous land position that we have there that had been de-risked by almost 102 wells that have been drilled, a large inventory of wells that are to be drilled. We'll probably have the opportunity to drill over 1,000 more wells. And then excellent access to natural gas markets coming out of the Piceance. And you can see on the right just a little bit of an illustration on what the Williams Park production formation looks like. You know, we all talk about the shale gas revolution, but the production in the Piceance is really not from shale, it's from tight sands, and they're stacked multiple sand and lenses over a 2,500 to 3,000 foot interval in the Williams Park formation. And that's the kind of production we're looking for in the Piceance, as others are. And the nice thing about the technology now, we have lower footprints in the Piceance and other places in the oil and gas industry. One of these pads can drill 25 to 30 wells off of one pad. I don't know if you can see there, but you can see the wells coming off like a spider leg, and you can tap the locations underground. But instead of having 30 pads on the surface, we'll have one pad. So it's great environmentally and softens the footprint. I put this slide in here just as an illustration of how gas flows out of the Piceance. You know, our gas flows from the wellhead to eventual cells on the right hand. The gas is gathered in the field by the gathering system of the operator. It goes through the Crawford Trail compressor station, and then it goes through what we call the parachute plant, which is a refrigeration plant. It knocks out condensate and some of the heavier natural gas liquids, such as propane and butane. Then that gas is gone. The remaining gas goes to one of three cryogenic plants where additional natural gas liquids are knocked out. Once it goes to the plants, it comes out of the tail gas of the plant as what we call residue gas, and then that gas is sold into the market. G2X markets and sells most of its own gas at what we call the White River Hub, and then that gas is taken to the Midwest or other places where other companies similar to us make other products. And then some of the gas is sold by our operating partner, Terra Energy, and then that gas is sold into the Colorado Interstate Market, and some of it ends up in Colorado and could end up in the Pacific Northwest and be utilized for the Jordan Cove LNG facility. So that's a short introduction of who we are. We're excited to be in the Piceance. We love the area, love the community, and we're happy to be partners with Terra, and always happy to hear the things that the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association is doing for the industry, and we want to be good partners and good stewards of the environment, and we're just excited to be part of this area. Thank you.
Thank you all for having us here today. I'm Bob Braddock with Jordan Cove Energy, and Jordan Cove Energy is a LNG export project being developed by Veresen Corporation out of Calgary, Alberta. Go ahead. That's the typical boilerplate, roll through that. Veresen is unlike the companies that Danny and Joe talked about, is a service provider. We are an infrastructure company, primarily in natural gas. We started our company with the construction of the largest natural gas pipeline in North America, running from northeastern British Columbia all the way to the city gates of Chicago, and have expanded upon that and now own other pipelines both in Canada and the US. We are half owner of the Ruby Pipeline, which is a primary conduit for moving gas from the Piceance west into Northern California. The Jordan Cove project is a continuation of that, and that what it does, it builds upon the Ruby Pipeline, which takes gas from the Opal, Wyoming hub, which gathers gas in the basin, brings it all the way to a market hub of Malin, Oregon, which is on the California border. And at Malin, there are pipelines that come in there from Canada, and then go out of there into Northern California and into Reno, Nevada, to serve that market. We would build a pipeline, the Pacific Connector Pipeline, which would be a part of our Jordan Cove project, to move natural gas to the West Coast, 233-mile pipeline to go to Coos Bay, Oregon. Next slide. And at Coos Bay, Oregon, we will be building a facility, the Jordan Cove project, which then takes the natural gas and liquefies it. And the reason you do that is that when you liquefy natural gas, you increase the density of the gas by 600 times, making it economic to transport in bulk, very much like you would oil or gasoline. The importance of that is what that does, it creates markets that can be now served by ship. So whereas historically North American gas has been landlocked, what happens when you liquefy it, you now can load it on a ship and it can go anywhere in the world. A little over a year ago, the first LNG export facility in the US, lower 48 US, was put online on the Gulf Coast, and since that time has been shipping gas essentially all over the world. We would do the same thing, with our focus being the Pacific Basin. Next slide. The facility is a fairly significant capital investment. Pipeline and the plant itself will total approximately $7 to $8 billion when we load in all interest during construction. We have the site in place, anticipate that this facility would be in service in 2024. It's a 5-year construction cycle. We are now in the final phases of a permitting cycle that seems to have gone on forever. We hope we're in the last stretch, and over the next 18 months should wrap things up and move forward. The facility has already been designed. We are in the process of selecting a contractor, which should be done next week. So we're about there after a very rigorous engineering design process, but the facilities are pretty straightforward. It's just essentially taking gas and running it through a giant refrigerator like you have in your kitchen. It just takes it down to minus 260 degrees, at which point natural gas becomes liquid. Next. You can then load it on a vessel. This is a picture of the Energy Horizon, and the Energy Horizon is one of the largest LNG vessels that can now transit the new Panama Canal. It has a capacity of 3.9 billion cubic feet of gas. to put that into context, all the gas produced out of northwestern Colorado today, about 1.5 BCF a day, plus or minus, if I'm not out of park. So we can essentially take 2 days of all the gas produced in western Colorado and load it on that. Our facility will load one of those vessels every 3.2 days. These facilities run like clockwork as infrastructure. We do not own the gas. We do not own the LNG. We provide a service to those who own the gas and those who want to use the gas. So our customers will be either producers, other transporters of gas, or end users. Our predominant customers for our facility are essentially Japanese utilities who rely on natural gas to keep the lights on in Tokyo. Next slide. This gives you a general footprint of where LNG is being produced today, historically, and the new centers. And the new centers that are being developed are the aquamarine or greenish dots. And you can see the two in North America. We have one in the Northwest, which comprises our facility and potential facilities in British Columbia, as well as a cluster of facilities on the U.S. Gulf Coast. These are new markets for North American natural gas. Next slide. The reason we are important and we believe our project, which has direct access to Piceance Basin gas, is important is that for our Japanese customers, the shipping time is 9 days to get that gas from North America to their facility. If they bring it from the Gulf Coast, it's twice that time. The importance of that, this is a continuous supply chain, just-in-time management. LNG is very expensive to store. They do not have enormous amount of LNG storage, so they have to have continuous replenishment of supply. The supply chain is important as in anything. I mean, just like Amazon tries to do everything they can to shorten that supply chain and the time, we are doing the same. The 9 days difference means that if our customers wanted to get all their gas out of the Gulf Coast versus out of Coos Bay, where we are located, they would need to have twice the number of vessels dedicated to bring that constant volume. Each of these vessels is approximately $200 to $250 million investment. So forget about operating costs, forget about the time, just capital investment. They're going to have twice as much in ships. To move our product, which is 1 BCF a day production, takes approximately 7 ships. It would take then 14 ships to do that if we were producing it and going to the same destination. Next slide. The destination. This is one of the destinations. This is a facility in Tokyo Bay owned by Tokyo Electric Power. It is their newest power plant and a storage facility. You can see the tankage there. They have two berths. That power plant alone, that complex of power plants, uses 0.84 BCF a day. That terminal and three others that are owned by TEPCO in Tokyo Bay receive 4 BCF a day. They receive a ship every 18 hours. It is a like clockwork, and therefore they are most concerned about not just price, but security of supply, reliability of delivery. They accomplish this by having diversity of supply, so they will not just rely on North America, they will go elsewhere. And historically, they have not had an opportunity to rely on North America. We provide them stability, reliability, and a new source. And this is very important. So it opens up the Piceance Basin gas to a whole new market with different characteristics that have historically been supported. And that's what we do. We're a service provider linking end users, such as the folks that in Japan, with the producers here in North America. And beyond that, we'll let her go. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll begin our moderated discussion. Do you want to move the chairs in the middle, or what are you more comfortable with, John?
It might be easier for the cameraman. We can slide them over.
Okay, do that. Maybe I'll. Hello, everyone. Thank you. On behalf of Consumer Energy Alliance, Colorado Mesa University Unconventional Energy Center, West Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association, and Chevron, I would like to welcome you to the third of our student energy series at CMU. We're going to have a panel discussion focused on the importance of responsible energy development in the context of jobs, the economy, and revitalization of the domestic manufacturing sector. This is a unique event for you all in the Piceance Basin. Key players in the manufacturing sector are revolutionizing how end users manage factory input and raw material costs by direct energy investments. Nucor Corporation, North America's largest steel manufacturer, G2X Energy, and future overseas customers of LNG export terminals like Jordan Cove LNG are leading the way in investing and providing markets for natural gas production in Western Colorado. These investments by manufacturers signify a new era of long-term partnerships between the natural gas industry and industrial consumers that provide large manufacturers with economic and environmental incentives to expand operations in the United States to take advantage of our abundant and secure natural gas resources. Our panelist members are Joe Stratman, Executive Vice President with Nucor Corporation; Danny Wilson, Executive Vice President, Upstream G2X Energy; Bob Braddock, Senior Project Advisor for Jordan Cove LNG, and will be moderated by John Harbaugh, Founder and President of Mercator Energy. So we'll begin by a 10-minute project overview from each of the panelists. And just to provide context for the moderated discussion, which will follow. And that will last 1 hour. And then we'll have time for about 20-plus minutes of Q&A from the audience. During the moderated discussion, if you have a question, please raise your hand, and I'll give you an index card and a pencil to write it out and hand it to John, our moderator, who will choose the question he thinks are most relative to the conversation that's ongoing. So this is an open forum, freedom of thought. We're in an academic setting, but we just ask that everyone be respectful. These gentlemen are not afraid of hard questions, but please be courteous and thoughtful in your questions and remarks. With that, please give a round of applause for our panelists and moderator. Thank you.
Joe, I believe you're up first.
Okay.
Not in these, or?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
How is everybody today? You have to be good on a day like today. It's gorgeous outside. First of all, I want to thank everyone for having us here today. This is really an exciting opportunity for Nucor to be on this panel and to be a part of the Western Slopes Colorado Oil and Gas Association. Our venture into the natural gas world, the oil and gas world, started probably about 2008, 2009, when we were up against some strategic hurdles in what we'll call our raw materials supply chain. And that led us down a path of education, which I've got to be honest with you, I'm not even sure I knew how to spell natural gas back in 2008, but now my team and I know a lot more about it, and we're very honored to be a part of this industry in a really small way that we are. So what I wanted to start today with is just give you some sense of who Nucor is, the breadth of our company, what we do, and hopefully tie in a little bit of why energy in general, natural gas specifically, is so important to our company. So our company is primarily, you'll know us as a steel making company, but we are a lot more than just a steel making company. We really have four strategic business focuses. We start with actually the raw material portion of our business. We own and operate recycling yards all across the country. In fact, we have one right here in Grand Junction called Western Metals Recycling. I believe it's over on 4th Street, 4th Avenue. I'm not sure if I got Street and Avenue right, but it's over on 4th. That is actually a new core company, Western Metals Recycling. We have approximately 65 or 75 similar locations all over the country, and we actually collect and recycle scrap metals, ferrous metals, steel, non-ferrous metals like copper and aluminum. We recycle these, so we take your old dishwashers, we take your old cars, we take your old washing machines. We break them down into the various usable components, and then we recycle them. We'll either use them ourselves internally, most of it. In some cases, we sell it to other industries that consume the copper and the aluminum. So we start with recycling. And our core raw material into our steelmaking process. But also as part of our raw materials strategy, scrap metal is actually a very, very precious commodity. There is not enough necessarily in the United States to supply all the needs. And indeed, it is a global commodity. So at different times in the economic cycle, you could have as much as 20-25% of all the scrap metal recycled in the United States sold offshore. So in 2008, we started noticing this trend and this change. We said we need to get a different element, another leg on the stool of our raw material strategy. And that leg took the form of a manufacturing plant in Louisiana, which uses a technology called DRI, directly reduced iron. This technology basically takes iron ore, processed iron ore from the ground, and heats it up and reduces it, almost melts it, but not quite liquid, but puts it into a very pure iron form. And guess what the energy source for a DRI plant is? Anybody? Natural gas. Now this DRI technology is not new technology. We did not create, you know, a new thing. It's been around for decades. And in fact, there was a DRI plant owned by another company in the state of Louisiana in the middle part of the 1990s. But guess what happened with natural gas prices back in the 90s, in the early part of the decade? They went from $2, $3, $4 all the way up into the 8, 9, 10. I think it even peaked up in the 12, 15 range. Somebody in here will know that better than me. And because the cost and the amount of natural gas used in that process is so influential, it actually put that company out of business. So guess what? We bought the assets of that company. We relocated those assets for our first plant on the island of Trinidad, just off the coast of Venezuela, because they had a long-term contract for natural gas at $2 a unit. We couldn't afford it in the United States at that time. But with the evolution of the shale gas revolution, and the energy revolution that's going on in the United States, we've been able to get natural gas at competitive prices. So we built a second plant in Louisiana, literally about a mile away from where that first plant that I talked about that had gone bankrupt and we bought it. We located a brand new plant about a mile away from that. So that's just an indication of how integrated and how important natural gas and the whole energy revolution that's going on in the United States, how important it is to manufacturers. So that's kind of our raw material strategy. Our raw materials then feeds a steel mill group. We have 28 steel mills spread around the country. We make about 20 million tons of steel. 85% of our raw material comes from recycled scrap metal. We are the nation's largest recycler. We're the nation's largest recycling company. Our steel goes into lots of different products. You'll see a collage of pictures here in a moment of the different things we our steel products go into. Our steel goes into different products, heavily dominated by construction, but automotive, energy. We sell about 1 million tons of steel to producers of OTCG pipe for the oil and gas industry. And then we also have a trading network where we trade steel around the globe. This is our footprint. So as you can see, we're a North American focused company, predominantly a US focused company, but we have facilities throughout North America, small footprint in Mexico, pretty large footprint in Canada, but we're primarily a US based company. And if I can read this correctly, the red dots represent our steel mills. The blue dots represent our steel products, where we make various and sundry products, mostly for construction. The yellow represents our raw materials facilities, which is, again, predominantly recycling activity, metals recycling activities. And then the dark blue represents
joint ventures.
Our purple, the purple color represents joint ventures. So that's our footprint. We have about 24,000 teammates across this footprint. We have a corporate culture that is focused on safety first, environmental compliance, productivity, profitability, working together. We have a very empowered, teamwork-oriented culture in our corporation. And I'll leave you and turn it over to the next speaker with, I'll tell you what our mission statement is. And if you walk up to almost any new core teammate, almost any of the 24,000 teammates around the country, in Canada and Mexico, almost every one of them can repeat for you what our mission statement is. And it goes like this: our mission is to take care of our customers. We define our customers as the people who use our products, as the teammates that we work side by side with, our shareholders, and the communities in which we live and work. We will accomplish this goal by being the safest, the highest quality, the lowest cost, most productive, and most profitable steel and steel products company in the entire world. We'll do this by being cultural and environmental stewards in the communities that we live and work, and we'll all accomplish this by working together. That is the mission statement of our company. That's what we live and breathe every day, and it's what we live and breathe across all 24,000 teammates. So with that short introduction to Nucor, I'll turn it over to Andrew.
Thank you. Danny Wilson, come up, please.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Joe, for your great talk. I want to thank the Colorado Mesa University, Chevron, and the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association for hosting this event and asking G2X to be part of the panel with such good experts from Nucor and Jordan Cove. I'm delighted to be here today to see and see all of you to learn more about the Piceance gas production and how that U.S. natural gas production is being used for LNG exports, which Bob is going to talk about, downstream petrochemical uses, which we're involved in, and the plant fuel to make products such as steel making done by Nucor, which you just talked about, some of which is made by others into oil field pipe that's used in the oil and gas industry. G2X Energy is a subsidiary of a global company, Proman Holdings AG, which is headquartered in Switzerland, but has operations in 9 other countries around the world. G2X, we develop, build, own, and operate vertically integrated petrochemical facilities in the U.S. where we can take advantage of the low-cost domestic natural gas that Joe was talking about. Right now, we operate a plant in Pampa, Texas, and in April 2016, the company announced a large acquisition where we bought 50% interest in a large facility that's going to be a methanol plant called Net Gasoline, and this facility is in Beaumont, Texas. When it's completed and on production, with first sales in September of this year, it'll be the largest methanol facility in North America. And combined, these two plants that we have will consume over 165 million cubic feet of natural gas, which is quite a large sum of natural gas. At the peak of the construction, which is occurring approximately now, the plant will have over 1,800 contractors, and on completion, we'll have more than 100 high-quality permanent jobs that will be working at the facility. As Joe talked about, this is one of the great outcomes of the U.S. gas production revolution that has occurred over the last 5 to 10 years. This abundant supply of low-cost natural gas, such as we have here in the Piceance, will help companies provide to workers quality jobs in the U.S. Nucor's steel manufacturing plants, the Jordan Cove LNG plant that you'll hear about after me, and G2X plants are just a few examples, and we're very excited, G2X is very excited to be part of this in a major way. Excuse me. Next slide. Since G2X's main product in the U.S. will be the conversion of natural gas to methanol, I thought I'd throw up a slide that gives you some information on methanol. I know when I first came to work for G2X, I've heard of methanol, but I didn't know all of the things that methanol is used for, and we encounter those daily in our lives. It's used to make many products like paints, plastics, formaldehyde, which is used to make adhesives, some of which are used to make plywood, cabinets and countertops that are used in the housing industry, many products that are used in the automotive industry. And methanol can also be used as a clean burning fuel to generate power and as an automotive fuel additive where it's blended into gasoline and diesel, and a lot of that helps companies lower the emissions of burning these fuels. Our strategy when I came on board is take advantage of the low-cost natural gas in the U.S. So what we looked at is where can we find a nice position with a great operator to come in and buy reserves in the ground? Because our plants, we're in the gas production business for the long haul. These plants are going to last 25 to 30 years. So what we looked at doing was buy gas reserves in the ground as a hedge against long-term natural gas prices. We're currently in a joint venture with a company called Terrier Energy Partners, which a lot of you are probably familiar with. They're a great partner. They bought out WPX's interest in the area and now are one of the major players in the Piceance Basin, and I know is very supportive in the local communities here. We made this investment for several factors. The size of the resource in the Piceance Basin, the continuous land position that we have there that had been de-risked by almost 102 wells that had been drilled, a large inventory of wells that are to be drilled, we'll probably have the opportunity to drill over 1,000 more wells. And then excellent access to natural gas markets coming out of the Piceance. And you can see on the right just a little bit of a illustration on what the Williams Park production formation looks like. We all talk about the shale gas revolution, but the production in the Piceance is really not from shale, it's from tight sands, and they're stacked multiple sand and lenses over a 2,500 to 3,000 foot interval in the Williams Park formation. And that's the kind of production we're looking for in the Piceance, as others are. And the nice thing about the technology now, we have lower footprints in the Piceance and other places in the oil and gas industry. One of these pads can drill 25 to 30 wells off of one pad. I don't know if you can see there, but you can see the wells coming off like a spider leg, and you can tap the locations underground. But instead of having 30 pads on the surface, we'll have one pad. So it's great environmentally and softens the footprint. I put this slide in here just as an illustration of how gas flows out of the peons. You know, our gas flows from the wellhead to eventual cells on the right hand. The gas is gathered in the field by the gathering system of the operator. It goes through the Crawford Trail compressor station, and then it goes through what we call the parachute plant, which is a refrigeration plant. It knocks out condensate and some of the heavier natural gas liquids, such as propane and butane. Then that gas is gone. The remaining gas goes to one of three cryogenic plants where additional natural gas liquids are knocked out. Once it goes to the plants, it comes out of the tail gas of the plant as what we call residue gas, and then that gas is sold into the market. G2X markets and sells most of its own gas at what we call the White River Hub, and then that gas is taken to the Midwest or other places where other companies similar to us make other products. And then some of the gas is sold by our operating partner, Terra Energy, and then that gas is sold into the Colorado Interstate Market, and some of it ends up in Colorado and could end up in the Pacific Northwest and be utilized for the Jordan Cove LNG facility. So that's a short introduction of who we are. We're excited to be in the Peons. We love the area, love the community, and we're happy to be partners with Terra, and always happy to hear the things that the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association is doing for the industry. And we want to be good partners and good stewards of the environment, and we're just excited to be part of this area. Thank you.
Thank you all for having us here today. I'm Bob Braddock with Jordan Cove Energy, and Jordan Cove Energy is a LNG export project being developed by Veresen Corporation out of Calgary, Alberta. Go ahead. That's the typical boilerplate, we'll roll through that. Veresen is unlike the companies that Danny and Joe talked about, is a service provider. We are an infrastructure company, primarily in natural gas. We started our company with the construction of the largest natural gas pipeline in North America, running from northeastern British Columbia all the way to the city gates of Chicago, and have expanded upon that and now own other pipelines both in Canada and the U.S. We are half owner of the Ruby Pipeline, which is a primary conduit for moving gas from the Peons west into Northern California. The Jordan Cove project is a continuation of that, and that what it does, it builds upon the Ruby Pipeline, which takes gas from the Opal Wyoming hub, which gathers gas in the basin, brings it all the way to a market hub of Malin, Oregon, which is on the California border. And at Malin, there are pipelines that come in there from Canada and then go out of there into Northern California and into Reno, Nevada, to serve that market. We would build a pipeline, the Pacific Connector Pipeline, which would be a part of our Jordan Cove project, to move natural gas to the West Coast, 233-mile pipeline to go to Coos Bay, Oregon. Next slide. And at Coos Bay, Oregon, we will be building a facility, the Jordan Cove project, which then takes the natural gas and liquefies it. And the reason you do that is that when you liquefy natural gas, you increase the density of the gas by 600 times, making it economic to transport in bulk very much like you would oil or gasoline. The importance of that is what that does, it creates markets that can be now served by ship. So whereas historically North American gas has been landlocked, what happens when you liquefy it, you now can load it on a ship and it can go anywhere in the world. A little over a year ago, the first LNG export facility in the U.S., lower 48 U.S., was put online on the Gulf Coast, and since that time has been shipping gas essentially all over the world. We would do the same thing with our focus being the Pacific Basin. Next slide. The facility is a fairly significant capital investment. Pipeline and the plant itself will total approximately $7 to $8 billion when we load in all interest during construction. We have the site in place, anticipate that this facility would be in service in 2024. It's a 5-year construction cycle. We are now in the final phases of a permitting cycle that seems to have gone on forever. We hope we're in the last stretch, and over the next 18 months should wrap things up and move forward. The facility has already been designed. We are in the process of selecting a contractor, which should be done next week. So we're about there. After a very rigorous engineering design process, but the facilities are pretty straightforward. It's just essentially taking gas and running it through a giant refrigerator like you have in your kitchen. It just takes it down to minus 260 degrees, at which point natural gas becomes liquid. Next. You can then load it on a vessel. This is a picture of the Energy Horizon. And the Energy Horizon is one of the largest LNG vessels that can now transit the new Panama Canal. It has a capacity of 3.9 billion cubic feet of gas. To put that into context, all the gas produced out of northwestern Colorado today, about 1.5 BCF a day. Plus or minus, if I'm not out of part. So we can essentially take 2 days of all the gas produced in western Colorado and load it on that. Our facility will load one of those vessels every 3.2 days. These facilities run like clockwork as infrastructure. We do not own the gas. We do not own the LNG. We provide a service to those who own the gas and those who want to use the gas. So our customers will be either producers, other transporters of gas, or end users. Our predominant customers for our facility are essentially Japanese utilities who rely on natural gas to keep the lights on in Tokyo. Next slide. This gives you a general footprint of where LNG is being produced today, historically, and the new centers. And the new centers that are being developed are the aquamarine or greenish dots. And you can see the two in North America. We have one in the Northwest, which comprises our facility and potential facilities in British Columbia, as well as a cluster of facilities on the U.S. Gulf Coast. These are new markets for North American natural gas. Next slide. The reason we are important, and we believe our project, which has direct access to Piceance Basin gas, is important, is that for our Japanese customers, the shipping time is 9 days to get that gas from North America to their facility. If they bring it from the Gulf Coast, it's twice that time. The the importance of that. This is a continuous supply chain, just-in-time management. LNG is very expensive to store. They do not have enormous amount of LNG storage, so they have to have continuous replenishment of supply. The supply chain is important as in anything. I mean, just like Amazon tries to do everything they can to shorten that supply chain and the time, we are doing the same. The 9 days difference means that if our customers wanted to get all their gas out of the Gulf Coast versus out of Coos Bay, where we are located, they would need to have twice the number of vessels dedicated to bring that constant volume. Each of these vessels is approximately $200 to $250 million investment. So forget about operating costs, forget about the time, just capital investment. It's they're going to have twice as much in ships. To move our product, which is one BCF a day production, takes approximately 7 ships. It would take then 14 ships to do that if we were producing it and going to the same destination. Next slide. The destination. This is one of the destinations. This is a facility in Tokyo Bay owned by Tokyo Electric Power. It is their newest power plant and a storage facility. You can see the tankage there. They have 2 berths. That power plant alone, that complex of power plants uses 0.84 BCF a day. That terminal and 3 others that are owned by TEPCO in Tokyo Bay receive 4 BCF a day. They receive a ship every 18 hours. It is a like clockwork, and therefore they are most concerned about not just price, but security of supply, reliability of delivery. They accomplish this by having diversity of supply, so they will not just rely on North America, they will go elsewhere, and historically they have not had an opportunity to rely on North America. We provide them stability, reliability, and a new source, and this is very important. So it opens up the Piceance Basin gas to a whole new market with different characteristics that have historically been supported. And that's what we do. We're a service provider linking end users, such as the folks that in Japan, with the producers here in North America. And beyond that, we'll let her go. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll begin our moderated discussion. Do you want to move the chairs in the middle, or what are you more comfortable with, John?
It might be easier for the cameraman. We can slide them over.
Okay, do that. Maybe I'll.
Scott, how are you? Is it on now?
No.
No.
Try now.
How about that?
Nope.
No. Nope. Testing, testing. Scott, can you hear me now?
You're gonna go grab some. I'll grab some.
Okay. Why don't I'll just stand up for a little bit while we chase down a microphone and introduce myself if I can. I think I know about half of the folks in the crowd. Can you hear me in the back right now, even without the mic? So far, so good. I always like to say I'm the 8th child out of a family of 9. And anytime I'm invited to speak, I still can't believe people want to hear what I have to say. So I appreciate the opportunity here. Always full of questions also. In fact, I think about the only time that I could speak growing up was when the meal was just served to all my older brothers and sisters. So full of questions today. I used to work for General Electric, an oil and gas company in Denver that was owned by GE. And from 1987 to 1992, I was put in charge of supplying natural gas to all the GE plants in the U.S. Jack Welch at the time thought that we would take our own production to those facilities, but our production was not situated where we could directly connect gas to a plant in Albuquerque, New Mexico, or East Stroudburg, Pennsylvania. So oftentimes we would sell our gas, take that cash, buy better situated gas, and move that gas to those facilities. But I had 55 General Electric plants east of the Mississippi River, and of those 55 plants, I'd say there are about 10 that are open right now. And so many of those plants closed since 1992 because of the cycle of gas prices. And what I think is unique in terms of what we have now here in the U.S., and is critically important to each one of these three gentlemen and their companies, is the security supply, the predictability supply, and the economics of that supply. Something that we really haven't seen until the shale revolution really took hold about 8 years ago. But what's interesting, a couple of these companies were even involved in this gas acquisition before the shale revolution started. And to quote a friend of mine, Porter Bennett, it's really obvious now that we're not living in a world of energy insecurity. We really have a superabundant commodity now that I think changes the world. And so really what I'd like to focus on is what's unique about the Piceance, what's unique about the Rockies, and then what caused you to come to the Piceance, and then Bob, for you, since you're really kind of a middleman between Asian customers and U.S. producers, what is it that those producers are looking for? So, Danny, I might start off with you. Can you tell us a little bit about, each one of you kind of avoided what your downstream investment is, but we're talking about billions of dollars of investment, and the thinking behind that investment had to relate directly to the availability of natural gas. So, can you expand on that a little bit, please?
Yes, John, thank you. That's correct.
That's working.
You're correct. The capital outlay for these large facilities are well north of $1 billion. I mean, you saw the cost of these LNG facilities. We're not...
Can't hear you.
He's rebooting. The system went down for some reason. He's
rebooting. Stands up. Look,
You're correct. What I was saying is the cost of these facilities are well north of $1 billion, and we're not in the neighborhood of the cost like the LNG facility is, but when you're looking at spending that kind of money to take natural gas and convert natural gas into some product, and that's why we have the name G2X, our main product now is methanol, but we have the option to convert into other products. But what we're looking for is a long-term supply of natural gas at a reasonable price, and coming to the Piceance allows us to put a hedge on natural gas and have long-term production. One of the things we looked at in coming to the Piceance was several things. One was to get with a great operator. We started out with WPX, that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Had friends there, great company. They got bought, the Piceance portion got bought out by Terra Energy Partners, great company. We've established a very good relationship with them as well. I know they're involved in the community here as well. But the opportunity in the Piceance for us is low risk, low cost natural gas. We can drill a thousand wells or more on our asset, and we have a fairly good idea of what those wells are going to look like, and that's very good for G2X. We're not an exploration company like some companies are, where they lease and drill and hope they make a certain well. So that's one of the reasons we came to the Piceance. And as I said earlier, our plants are going to last 30 years or more, and so we're looking for a long call on natural gas for the next 25 to 30 years. The two facilities we have now are just a start for G2X, and we're looking to build other facilities along the Gulf Coast, Texas, and possibly Louisiana as well.
Is this working now?
Yeah,
a little bit better?
Like,
if you can even turn it up a little more. Joe, I know that there were several, half a dozen direct reduction. That's great.
That's it.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now? This is like a Sprint commercial. Joe, there were about a half a dozen direct reduction in our plants closed many, many years ago. Can you talk about why they were closed? And then was the decision to build your plant predicated on the natural gas solution?
Right. Yeah, if you go, if you roll back the clock, as I said in my opening remarks, the technology, which we call DRI, or directly reduced iron, is a technology to take iron ore that's mined out of the ground and reduce it or turn it into a usable, more pure iron source for a steel mill. So that's the basic concept. The DRI technology uses natural gas as the energy source to perform that purification or reduction process. And John, as you said, there were half a dozen or so DRI plants built in the United States probably in the late 80s through the mid to late 90s. And they were all successful from a technological standpoint. But when we hit the extreme spikes of natural gas costs, they became uneconomical. So having economical natural gas is one of the requirements to making a DRI plant successful. So as I said, when we had the need to diversify our raw materials supply chain and we looked at DRI as a possible solution, we said, we made the decision right up front, natural gas costs are something we have to put under our own control in some way, shape, or form to avoid the volatility. So similar to Danny's situation, we're not in the natural gas business. We're not a partner in the natural gas business to be a true E&P company to drill and sell the natural gas. We're in it as a cost hedge for our production operations. Back in early part of the 2000s, we bought the equipment from one of those previously operating but financially bankrupt companies in Louisiana, and we moved that technology to the island of Trinidad. The only reason we did that was because we could get long-term natural gas prices at, as I said, $2, averaging over about a 20-year contract that averages about $2 a unit. That's the kind of economic certainty we need in natural gas pricing to make these DRI plants economically viable. So as the natural gas and oil and gas revolution started unfolding in the United States, and our need for raw material diversification continued to grow, we said, these DRI plants are pretty good things. Let's build another one. And this time we can maybe bring it back to the United States. So we sent a team of folks, some of my teammates who are actually sitting in the room today, to explore what are the opportunities that we can have to hedge natural gas prices to make this viable. And they came back with some of the very traditional derivative, long, you know, by the strip things. But they also came back with this strategy, which we're now employed in, which is to have a own a working interest partnership with a operating partner. So then we went on the trail to explore and look for operating partners. And the first thing we look for are companies that fit our culture. They treat their teammates well, they treat their communities well, they're environmentally responsible operators. And we had a number of people that fit that bill. There's a number of great operators. We ended up choosing a partner in a company by the name of Encana, who you all know, I'm sure, and we started drilling wells with them. And that's where we are today. We have a position that we can drill when we need the gas, and as prices rise, when I see Danny's project, Bob's project, and we see all the conversion of electricity generation moving from coal to natural gas, you know, I think the pricing outlook over the long run for natural gas is bullish. And so as those prices rise, we will be more active drilling. But our main purpose here is to have a steady cost or a controllable cost of natural gas. The investment in a DRI plant isn't quite as big as Danny's plant, but we're going to be slightly under $1 billion, probably around $800 million for one plant. We now have two of these plants operating with the footprint and the infrastructure to build more as needed, as Nucor grows and as our demand grows. So we're very excited with the position we have, and that's kind of the reason, the history of why we're here.
I,
I actually feel like you gentlemen are apologizing for not spending more than $1 billion. Bob, you talked a little bit about the different characteristics that the demand in Asia represents. And it's interesting, I think if you describe those characteristics, they match up with what these two gentlemen were looking for their companies. Can you talk a little bit about that and talk about Jared, maybe their visit here also?
Yes, you know, as I mentioned, our business is that of a service provider to typically end users. In our case, the majority of the end users that we are dealing with tend to be power producers. Power producers in Asia, principally in Japan at this point, and they have the same concerns that Joe and Danny have expressed for their own companies. In other words, energy is a component, it's a cost component to achieve something else in their production chain. Our utilities that we deal with in Japan are electric utilities. They can get electricity a number of ways. The dominant way that Japan was pushing to generate electricity was via nuclear power. That all changed with the Tokyo event, and they had relied upon natural gas primarily as a backup and blending. Now their whole portfolio has shifted to less reliance on nuclear and a much higher reliance on natural gas. So they need to get more of it. And then the question becomes is, where do we get it? There are many places they can get it from. They can get more from Australia. Currently, they get approximately 29% of their natural gas supplies from Australia. They currently get 10% from Russia. They get probably around 25% from Oceania, in Indonesia, Malaysia, Brunei. A large chunk, around another 25% or thereabouts, from the Middle East. They get essentially zero from North America. What they want to do is get diversity of supply globally. And they are looking at it globally because of issues of political stability, price stability, geographic stability, and this is important, because weather disruptions from a facility in the Gulf Coast. You get a hurricane come through in the Gulf Coast, they don't want all of their production to come from the Gulf Coast, even if it comes from North America. So they want different portals to bring in North American gas. We see us as being able to give them that versatility. The other thing we do uniquely in terms of North American LNG facilities, at least presently, is that we have access to different supply basins than typically supply directly the Gulf Coast facilities. In other words, you do not see natural gas from the Rockies typically moving into the Gulf Coast. It's being displaced by other production areas that are closer. But what we do have is an infrastructure that is essentially already in place. Again, you can talk about building a plant, you can talk about drilling the wells. You've got to find a way to get it from point A to point B. Just as folks have talked about, well, we'll buy gas and put it into our facility. Well, yeah, but where I buy gas is over here. I may have to swap it. What you can do with Pion's Basin gas is essentially find a direct conduit to get it to the West Coast. So in other words, we can see our customers in Japan. Some have already come into the Pion's Basin to look around and doing the same sorts of things that Joe and Danny's company have done to try and vertically integrate to protect their supplies long term, because they have the same cycles in a power plant. That's a 20-25 year investment. They want to make sure they have fuel for that 20 or 25 years, so it's not stranded or the prices aren't through the roof. I think the other thing, and folks might not like to hear this, one of the other benefits that a facility that we have on the West Coast where we are located and linked to the Malin Hub is that not only do we have access to Piance Basin gas, but we have access to Western Canadian sedimentary basin gas. Or it's two sources of supply linked to an output. From a customer standpoint, that's ideal because they're not dependent on one source. It's a North American traded commodity, so they have versatility. And assurance of supply is what that also provides them. So it would, in some ways, be undesirable to only have access to Piance Basin gas because there are unique characteristics of that basin from a pricing standpoint, from a production standpoint. An end user wants flexibility, but this can be a core asset, but one of many, and that's what we intend to provide them, and that's why they look at us.
With all due respect, Bob, just make sure when you're talking to those Japanese clients that you tell them about our great peaches and Olathe corn here. So when they buy our gas, they can come here rather than go to Canada. Danny, the next question is for you. It comes from one of the students. They're really curious about the economics. What does the price have to be for oil and gas to do the NGL conversion? And what do you foresee going into the future here?
Well, that's a good question. For our facilities, we monitor that, quite a bit. And what we try to do strategically is drill the wells and get the lowest cost gas that we can. Of course, now, buying gas off the pipe is relatively low as well. The break-even prices of our plants, I probably wouldn't want to get into too much of the economics on that, but I know it's well south of $4. So
where we are right now.
Yeah, right now the prices are good for us. From a strategic standpoint, what we're really looking for is to keep the long call on gas for gas prices that may be $5 or $6 in 2030 or years after that, because these plants produce so long. So that's really where the long call of gas comes in.
And I hope you can hear, but Joe, that was really the same story. As long as you knew prices wouldn't exceed a certain amount, that helped the decision to build that $1 billion plant.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a very similar economic model. We, as I mentioned, we had the plant in Trinidad. And let's just give you a perspective. Before we built these DRI facilities, Nucor consumed probably somewhere in the area of 20 B per year of natural gas in our other steelmaking facilities. These facilities alone, the one in Trinidad and the one here, probably consume somewhere in the vicinity of 20 to 25 Bs by themselves. So these two plants virtually tripled our gas use. That's why it became so important. But yes, you're correct. When we looked at the economics that we had in the plant in Trinidad and considering transportation of the material from Trinidad to the U.S., the DRI material, we kind of had a ballpark in mind that if we could get natural gas in that $4 range and we had it at that price or slash cost or better, that was a push. We could build a plant here in the United States and have the same economics as we had in Venezuela. Turns out we've been able to do better than that. So it's a real win for us.
And I hope you can hear me in the back, but we have a new president that's talked a lot about trade. International trade and tariffs. What sort of impact do you expect to see on the steel industry? Do you think foreign countries will be able to dump steel the way they have in the past?
We hope not. from a steel industry perspective, and I know we're getting a little bit out of the energy world now, but for the steel industry globally, the largest challenge we have is excess global supply of steelmaking. In China alone, China doubled the world's steelmaking capacity in about a 10 to 15 year window. So right now, today, you'll read numbers that are a little bit different, but there's probably about anywhere from 500 to 700 million tons of excess steelmaking capacity around the globe. To give you a perspective of that, in the United States, the entire United States consumes about 100 million tons a year. So global excess capacity is seven times the U.S. steel industry. That's the largest headwind we have. And when you look at a country like China, most of the steel mills, I would say all, but I think that's probably a little bit inaccurate, but it's up there by 80-90% of all the steel making capacity is actually owned by the government. So it's not owned by a publicly owned company or a privately owned company that's looking to make a profit. They are, it's government owned, government controlled. They have motives that sometimes aren't always profit motives, and therefore they have a tendency to move their steel around the world at less than true or fair economic value, which is what we call dumping. And there are laws against that in global trade at the WTO, there are laws against that. And we try to actively hold our government accountable to enforce those laws. With every administration that we've gone through, there's a bit of more urgency or less urgency paid to some of these things. At least with Mr. Trump, the approach he's taken and the plans he's set out give us some comfort that he will enforce the trade laws. And let me be clear about this. We are not looking for protectionism. We are simply looking for a fair and level playing field that all the economies of the world have agreed to play by these rules of trade. We're not looking for any special consideration. We're just looking for the trade laws around the globe to be fairly enforced. So we're optimistic that the Trump administration will be put this at a higher priority than maybe other administrations have, but it's still to be shown.
Bob, your turn for a student question. One of the tougher ones, I think. One of the benefits of the Piceance Basin, as you know, is the available pipeline capacity, gathering, processing, you name it. The pinch point getting up to Jordan Cove is clearly the Pacific Gas Connector. Do you anticipate the kind of response the DAPL pipeline received going forward?
The first caveat I'll make is that building any linear project is a difficult situation. And it's a difficult situation because linear projects impact people directly, the landowners that it crosses. And that's a very sensitive issue for everyone. And there are, in our case, we have somewhere in the range of 300 landowners that we are crossing. What you need to do as a developer, builder of a pipeline or a power line would be the same issues, or water line, doesn't matter, where you're going across properties that will potentially impact the use of that property. You need to spend a lot of time working with the landowners before the point at which they believe they have no choices. In other words, you need to do honest, straightforward negotiations with the landowners to accomplish an amicable agreement. If you can do that, you can be successful. If you fail to do that, you may ultimately get a pipeline built, but you will not be successful. You will have engendered a great deal of animosity. So we've worked very hard in Oregon to do that. Right now we have acquired approximately 38% of the right-of-way on private land. A good deal of our right-of-way is on public lands, which you get when you get a certificate. And a lot of the right-of-way is also on timber company land, which are it's a business decision on their part, so it's not a not a problem. But when you deal with the landowner who has a 30-acre parcel or a 100-acre parcel and you're going to impact it, you've got to it's got to be a one-on-one arrangement, and it's a long-term relationship. So you just have to work the problem. If you fail to work the problem, you can create all the dust ups in the world. I am not going to tell you that everyone will be 100% happy with the outcome, but in a typical pipeline project of this scale, in that location, you will be successful in negotiating with virtually 95% to 98% of the individual landowners, and maybe 2-3% or so might end up getting to the point where you actually reach a point where the issue of eminent domain does enter into play. That has been typical for our projects in the past, both in Canada and in the U.S. Others may have a different experience, but it requires a long-term process.
And this is a question both for Joe and Danny. If my memory serves me, you were involved in the peons long before we really saw the increase in the mancos. I said, Danny and Joe, a question for you. You were involved in the Piceance Basin long before the Mancos shale gas in place numbers were adjusted by the USGS early last year. I'm just curious, when you first heard about the shale revolution, and really based on the investment that was directed at the Williams Fork, what did it mean to your companies individually to realize you had that sweetener below you, and the sweetener is probably not doing it justice in the Niobrara and Mancos?
Thank you, John. We're G2X is well aware of the, you know, the deeper horizons in the Manco Shale and the Niobrara. Unfortunately, when we did our deal, we only have rights to the Williams Fork, so we don't have the deeper rights. But to further answer your question, I've been involved in the shale early on, probably late 90s and early 2000s, when really the Barnett Shale was sort of the big shale producer, and then it moved into a lot of other basins with that technology. But that's going to be a very, the Mancos and Niobrara is going to be a very nice additional asset for the folks that are in the Piceance, but we're currently not part of that.
Yeah, we got involved in the partnership, the working interest partnership, back in 2010, so it was not too far off from when some of these other formations were known about and found, but certainly the value of those has improved, and the technology to access that gas in those different layers and those different fields has improved. So obviously that's a big boom for us. When we entered our first arrangement with Encana, we had, similar to Danny, we didn't have access to all depths. But we have since, what that's allowed us to do is concentrate our geographical footprint, and instead of having this much land this deep, we've got this much land this deep. So what we've done is concentrated our geographical position, our acreage, expanded some depths, and clearly it provides us, just like Danny and Bob, our projects are 30 and 40 years in life, so it gives us much more opportunity and much more gas to access, and it actually gives us much more security in the position we have.
When the shale revolution was in its second or third year of reality, the LNG boom really kind of took off, and I'd say we're seeing it in waves. One of my clients is Dyno Nobel, and they're based out of Australia, and they turn natural gas into ammonia. Now, they've been devastated down in Australia because of all of the preponderance of LNG export plants down there. The gas price ran to $8 an MMBTU in some parts of Australia. So Dyno actually, like you, invested down in Louisiana and built about $1.4 billion plant to turn natural gas into ammonia. How do you feel about Mr. Braddock here sitting next to you possibly developing LNG plants? And This isn't meant to be a gotcha question. I have an answer that I'd like to share once you kind of go through here, so.
So do I. Actually, I'm very happy he's doing this, okay? Because I think one of the big pictures, we've spoken already, we spent an hour, whatever it's been, talking about our specific companies. But I think there's a much bigger picture here. And I think Bob's company is a great example of what this can do for the United States of America. You know, today we have a $21 trillion debt in this country. And we're running about $500 million a year trade deficit globally, okay? That is an unsustainable path. That's just an unsustainable economic model. Okay. So anything we can do as a country to reduce our trade deficit, improve the wealth creation for our citizens, for our fellow citizens, for our neighbors, anything we can do to increase that wealth, I think is a positive thing, okay? So with what's the revolution, the energy revolution, the amount, our trade deficit used to be about 50% of the trade deficit was represented by energy. Today that number's dropped to about a third, I think. Somebody in the room might actually know that statistic better than me. But I think we've moved that trade deficit down. We've moved it down substantially. It used to be close to $1 trillion a year. It's down to about $500 million last year. The energy component of that has moved down from about 50% of all the trade deficit down to about a third of all the trade deficit, okay? That is an economic win for the United States. That's an economic win for the country, for middle class America, the folks that'll work in jobs like Bob's plant and Danny's plant and our plant. So I'm very bullish about what he's doing. I don't fear that as competition at all, in any sense of the word. In other words, if demand for natural gas goes through the roof and prices go through the roof, that's why we made the strategic decision. I'm okay with that. I wish him all the success in the world because he's creating American jobs. And I think at the end of the day, the opportunity that you have provided us in this part of the country, but also throughout the energy revolution, what you have provided us is you've provided us another opportunity to go through an industrial age where we can reshore manufacturing in this country and once again build a manufacturing base that can sustain health and wealth and happiness in the United States. Over the last 10 years, we've lost about 6 million manufacturing jobs, and they've gone overseas for a variety of reasons, okay? But certainly energy availability was one of those reasons, and this is just going to help bring some of those jobs back to the United States. So I'm not challenged by it at all.
Danny?
That's good, Joe. We're in the same situation. We're not challenged by that either. As Joe said, there were so many jobs lost. When the gas prices and oil prices dropped, say from $100 a barrel and higher gas prices in the $4 to $6 range, several hundred thousand good jobs in the energy industry were lost. And with this demand situation that Bob and other companies are creating with LNG, making gas, the U.S. natural gas more fungible and being a global product, that's really good for the U.S. We're able to build plants, we're able to drill more wells, and that's high quality jobs that are going to come back to the U.S.
Yeah, and this is not self-serving. I've been in the energy business all my life, and actually been in the methanol business, and I was trained as a metallurgist, and my family's in the
steel business. Great.
So I can see it from all the angles, but I think some things that we all need to consider that is essentially new. When I was an early engineer, I went to my first energy conference. I won't tell you how long ago, but it's nearly half a century ago. And the big complaint then on natural gas was there was only 10 years worth of supply. And no one could justify doing any more than that. And as a result of that lack of comfort that there was sufficient supply, people were unwilling to make long-term investments. That's why we built coal plants rather than natural gas power plants. And it becomes somewhat of a self-fulfilling prophecy. What has happened with the shale gas revolution is supply is no longer a concern. There's plenty of it out there. It's at what price? And we all believe it's a reasonable price. And we don't need $12 to find it. There's no finding cost. We know where it is. So if we look at our energy infrastructure in North America, our primary uses when we lost all the manufacturing that were using natural gas was heating and power, both of which tend to be cyclical businesses. By building an industry strictly on cyclical businesses, you do not build the reliability or the comfort for the producers to go out and develop additional reserves. By putting base load underneath it all, the plants that Danny and Joe run and LNG facilities that we run 24/7. Steady loads day in, day out, day in and day out. This gives the producers the comfort to go and drill and create production, as well as the infrastructure providers to build the infrastructure because they have a good steady load. So it essentially is somewhat counterintuitive. The higher, as long as you're not resource constrained, the more you can build a base of steady, large use, the more stable will be the total supply for everyone.
And I'd love to underscore, if I can, maybe become one of the panelists for a moment. Every other year, I speak to the ammonia manufacturers at their annual conference. And 3 years ago, I put up a shale revolution slide. And my first slide was really that classic cartoon picture of Lucy and Charlie Brown, where she holds a football. And I said, I promise you, this time it's real. This price will stay low for quite some time. Put it up in front of 600 people, and no one laughed. You know, having dealt with end users most of my life and producers, we're all seeking that predictability of price. So much so, last night I was sitting next to a gentleman that runs Ensign Drilling, a big drilling company. He said, if I had more people right now, I could have 4 more rigs running the Denver-Julesburg Basin. Well, we lost people on the production side of the business because of this cycle of prices. And what I've always wanted to see and invited, and what I fell in love with, was the Nucor story, where one of the huge issues we have as producers is credit worthiness of a counterparty. So if you came to us and said, look, we want to do a 20-year deal for $100,000 a day, when you run the numbers on it, that exceeds $5 billion. So how do I know you're going to be there over 20 years with that promise to keep paying the price that we had agreed to 19 years ago? And so I was fascinated by the Nucor deal. It was the first that I saw. And quickly after that, we saw G2X. But those characteristics that I think the Asian suppliers are looking for, or Asian buyers are looking for, is this predictability of price. Even so much as the guy who used to be a truck driver for a gas, oil and gas company that shifted over to long-haul trucking, he wants to know that he has the job over and over and over again. And so I just underscore, there's a place above $3.25, and I know we're probably not supposed to fix prices here in this room, but $3.25 means we can produce a lot of gas out of the Piceance Basin. And I think that there was a price threshold for each one of you, and probably for the Asian producer, saying, as long as I know it doesn't exceed X price, we can go out there and drill. I think that's what's unique to our world right now. Joe, I want to pick on you if I can for a minute now. So 2.5 years ago, the Saudis decided not to amend their production quota. They did not decrease it in order to maintain higher prices. If you had an oil and gas guy that was arguing with you, and I'm playing devil's advocate here, the saying, well, hey, they're dumping oil on the world market also. How is that any different than steel? I've talked to some of your people in the past that said your DRI method is so efficient that you'll stare down any steelmaker in the world if it's favorable in terms of competition. Most of the U.S. producers in the last 2 years have survived some pretty debilitating prices because of our efficiency. Can you talk a little bit about the DRI method and how it stacks up against other steel types in the world?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, again, just a little background here. There's basically two methods to making steel, right? One, you use scrap metal, which is what Nucor does most of the time. Nucor is about 90% scrap metal. And the other one is to take iron ore out of the ground and convert it into something that a steel mill can use. There's lots of different technologies, but there's really kind of two proven, long-term, stable technologies. One is called a blast furnace. If you think about a blast furnace, this is what you think about when you think about Pittsburgh and the heyday of the steel industry. And then DRI is the alternative production route. You know, the numbers, depending on how efficient a manufacturer you are, could vary a little bit. But basically, the DRI costs will be somewhere around 70% compared to the blast furnace cost. And as importantly, quite frankly, is the carbon footprint of a DRI plant is about one third for the same production rate as a blast furnace. So it is technologically proven. It is more cost effective. So it keeps our conversion costs, our production costs, lower than our domestic and global competitors who use the more traditional blast furnace. And it's got a much, much better environmental footprint than the other proven alternative. There are other folks, including Nucor, that experiment with other technologies from time to time, looking to be that low-cost producer, looking to push the envelope on environmental friendliness even more and more. But those are the two main routes right now. So we believe our DRI plant gives us a strongly cost-competitive position versus our global and domestic competitors, and also is much, much better for the environment.
And Danny, how do you stack up from a methanol standpoint with worldwide production?
As far as methanol production?
Yes.
Well, the good thing about G2X and our parent company, Proman, is we have a sister company called Southern Chemical Corporation, and we have ocean-going vessels, and we can market methanol anywhere in the U.S., or we could take that production anywhere in the world. So obviously we have to be competitive on the price, but we see that building this plant, we'll be able to move that methanol to wherever we want to move that and be competitive anywhere, really anywhere in the world.
How fungible is methanol? Do you ship it? And can you?
Yes, methanol is very fungible because it's a liquid and you can ship it just like crude oil. You do not have to have the low temperature facilities that you have for LNG. So you make it and you store it in tanks, regular tanks, just like oil. So it's very fungible. You can pipe it to a port or however you get it to the vessels. You can ship it on barges because it doesn't require that temperature lowering to compress or make liquid out of natural gas. So it's very fungible and can be moved anywhere in the world. And some of the things we're looking at as well is, you know, methanol is a very clean burning fuel, and some of the things we're looking at is to go into markets where electric generation is being done currently by diesel because there's no access to natural gas. Some of these might be island countries where they're just not going to build a deep gasification facility where they would bring in LNG, and so we can ship methanol to those countries and hopefully displace electricity that's being generated by diesel. It's great for the environment, and we're happy to be part of that, and that's one of the things that we're looking at very heavily.
Question for you, Bob. During the Obama administration, there was a freeze put on for 22 months, a freeze put on the issuance of any LNG licenses by the DOE. And for me, as a natural gas industry employee, I looked at that as that administration deciding that a chemical job might be more important than an oil and gas job. And I think they fundamentally, they either understood or chose to ignore it, that it wasn't a shrinking pie of supply, it was an ever-larging, growing pie of natural gas supply. How do you feel about the new administration? What sort of cooperation or oversight do you expect to see over the next 4 years?
I'm probably better at speaking to how things were than how things might be. Who knows? But, you know, just to clarify, I think, you know, one of the things that occurred over the past administration, and this is both terms, is that they were involved during the emergence of the shale oil and shale gas industries. In other words, prior to that time, prior to 2008, there was a real question as to whether the developments that looked like they were going to create this abundance of natural gas were truly sustainable. I mean, you have large oil companies who have theoretically very smart people, very skeptical. Our own business was skeptical. We started our project in 2004 as an import facility, because at that point in time, that is what the future looked. We were running out of gas in North America. That all changed as technology evolved. So when the administration put the brakes on issuance of export license, I think part of it was certainly some within the industry were concerned that it was still a scarce resource, and that being a scarce resource, they were going to have to fight tooth and nail to hold on to it, and they didn't want to lose any of it because the prices were going to go up. I think the failure of all of us, and myself as well, is to understand that what has truly happened in the shale industry, clearly on the gas side and now occurring on the oil side, is this issue of the applicability of Moore's Law, and that it is a manufacturing process now. It is not a finding process. We know where it is. Now it's a question of efficiency of extraction, and you gain that efficiency by repetition. The old Boston Consulting Group, you know, that is what we're seeing in the industry. The more you produce, the smarter you're at, you drive your cost structure down. That's what's occurred, and that's what's still occurring. So I think what we now have is this broader understanding that that is the situation we find ourselves in, and that is why my exporting of LNG is not threatening to Joe and Danny, because they see this. I mean, we all see it in the industry that the more we can produce as a country, the better our domestic industry will be. We have a head start. The technologies for horizontal drilling and fracking will be applied internationally and are being so. But as long as we keep progressing and keep developing, we will always have an advantage. As soon as we sit back and stop, that is when we will lose it, because the others won't stop. They will start getting smarter than we are. And I think that's what has occurred, and that's why I am at this point, if not confident, at least optimistic about the fact that the current administration will continue based upon that paradigm, that we have an abundance of energy and we need to maintain our advantage. And the way we do that is to stimulate markets for it.
And then a follow-up, Bob. We have been fortunate to travel to China quite a bit in the last 10 years. And if anyone's been to Beijing for a day, you can tell how much they are in need of natural gas supply, at least to generate electricity. It seems today that we might be selling natural gas out of the Piceance, and it's our hope, through Jordan Cove to Japan. Can you see U.S. natural gas displacing coal-fired generation in China someday?
We have been approached by Chinese purchasers of natural LNG. Other facilities as have done so as well. So it will occur. They are in the market. They understand the environmental problems that reliance on their domestic coal industry has created. And they now have a middle class that is expressing their dissatisfaction sufficiently to cause the government to change some of their patterns. So yes, absolutely. We will be a supplier. We as a nation will be supplying LNG to China at some point in time.
And then from my perspective, we represent about, my company is about 25 different producers in many, many basins across the U.S. But the Piceance Basin and the outreach that you see here seems to be unique to me. Can you each perhaps describe the surprise that you've experienced over the last few years and the involvement of the local community and what the production means to this community? Just start with Danny.
Yeah.
Well, G2X has been very excited to be here in the Piceance Basin and part of the Western Slope Colorado Oil and Gas Association. We stay involved in that, and our operator, Terra Energy, is very involved in that. And it's really a nice community here. We're just delighted to be here and have our production, and hopefully over the next few years we'll continue drilling. And we love being here, and obviously it's a beautiful place. When I come here out of Houston, it's very lovely. I've got to go home today, and it's going to be 85 degrees, and so it's going to be quite a shock. But the production here is in very, very lovely places, and I know all the operators are very attuned to the environment, as we are, and I know our operator is. And I get emails from David, from the association, and it's a really a close-knit community, and we're delighted to be involved in it.
Yeah, I really echo Danny's comments. We're very happy to be a part of this community. We're very happy to be a part of not only the natural gas industry, the Western Slopes Oil and Gas Association. We're really very happy to be a part of the Colorado economic scene. As I mentioned, we have some facilities already in Colorado, not natural gas, but we have our recycling facilities here in Grand Junction and in Aurora, and we've been active participants in Colorado. We've won, for instance, our recycling yard here in Grand Junction and Aurora have won awards from the Colorado Public Safety and Health Department for Environmental Progress. We've won the state's environmental award a number of times. So I guess my point is, in saying all that, is all of the communities that we get involved in, we try to be active parts of the community, because let's face it, our teammates that work at our Western Metals Recycling here are part of your community. I mean, they live in your neighborhoods. Their kids go to school with your kids. Okay, they play ball with you. So that is the way we view community, whether it's here on the Western Slope, whether it's in Aurora, whether it's in Louisiana, Convent, Louisiana, where our Deer Art facility is. That's the way we try to embrace the communities. We hope that we're a good partner. We certainly want feedback when you hear that we are. We certainly want feedback when you hear we can do something better. But that's part of our core culture. It's part of the nature of Nucor to be community involved in the community, because we are part of it. Literally, our teammates are part of this community, and we're proud to be here.
Yeah, the issue of community, and while we're not directly involved with the Western Slope community, we certainly have our community in Oregon where our facility is, and it is clearly important to us that we are accepted and part of the community. We have been met with open arms in Coos County and Coos Bay, highly supportive of our efforts, and we have in return tried to demonstrate our appreciation of that. We have clearly, in our case, because we are in a coastal area, marine environment, fisheries, and timber are the primary natural resources that are handled in the area, and energy is not something that they think much about. We are in the process of creating we purchased a golf course, 120-acre golf course that was created by damming up a tributary to the Coos River, and it destroyed habitat. And this was typical back in the late 1800s to create farmland, because it's very steep and hilly out there, very little flat. So what they do is they put a dike and make a pasture behind it. What we have in the process of doing is converting that to coho habitat. It'll be by itself about a $35 million rehabilitation project, but it will create the largest single coho habitat improvement project ever conceived on the West Coast, and we're proud of that, because we feel that demonstrates to the community that we understand their values. It is very much like here. There's a mix of ranchers and energy that coexist. And I think that is a very important symbol of how this country needs to work. And we do it there, we do it here. There's a lot of similarities between the folks in Southwest Oregon and the folks in Western, on the Western Slope, and that's great.
Thank you. 38 years ago, I hate to even say that number, I decided to go into oil and gas because it was a business that extracted something from the ground and created wealth, and created opportunity, created jobs. It's just terrific to meet three people that are involved in those jobs that I would really argue come out of the wealth of the resources we have here in this country. So with that, I'd just like everyone here today to thank COGA for hosting this, and to thank our three panelists here.